Monsters have been a staple of fiction for centuries, a fixture of folklore for millennia untold. Among the most prevalent creatures of the night is the prestigious vampire. Now, tales of blood-drinking undead started in Eastern Europe, made their way west in the 17th and 18th century. However, it was Bram Stoker's seminal 1897 novel Dracula that codified, if not outright invented, the tropes of these stories, such as turning into a bat, vulnerability to wooden stakes, and being allergic to the sun.
Did you see Little Brittle? Because he's not supposed to be out in the sunlight. No!
34 years later, Universal Pictures, who'd been making bank on campy monster-driven horror films such as The Phantom of the Opera, released Dracula, a film adaptation of the novel starring film legend Bela Lugosi, giving a canon face to the literary character who would go on to appear on Reese's Peanut Butter Cups anime and the subject of tonight's documentary. Now let's flash forward about a century from Dracula's publication, and once again we find ourselves in the radical 90s. Everyone was clad in plaid, fighting games reigned supreme. Capcom were the undisputed kings of this genre, despite only having one franchise. If they could rule the gaming scene with just one game, imagine what they could do with two, they thought, probably. So naturally, they took the next step forward and expanded their brands by acquiring the license to Marvel's X-Men. But that's not why we're here today. Developed concurrently with X-Men Children of the Atom was a little game based on the Universal movie monsters like the Mummy, the Wolfman, and most importantly, the Vampire. So pour yourself a wine glass of human blood, cozy up in your coffin as we take a look at the development of Darkstalkers.
Dad, that's his crotch.
Unfortunately, Capcom USA's Alex Jimenez was unable to secure the rights to the characters, and the deal fell through almost immediately. See, because unlike Marvel, Universal wasn't on the verge of filing Chapter 11. Now, this minor setback forced Capcom to create original characters adhering to the same monster archetypes as seen in the movies, albeit with different names and backstories. After all, Universal owned Bela Lugosi's Dracula specifically, but not Stoker's Dracula, let alone the nebulous concept of vampires. Those were public domain. The same could be said of werewolves, Frankensteins, you name it. It was Haro Murata who was in charge of breathing life into these generic stock characters, create a fleshed out world for them to inhabit as well. His idea was basically to make a horror movie Street Fighter, where instead of having characters who represent various martial arts from around the globe, they'd have monsters, each representing the folklore of different world cultures. You know, you got your Romanian vampires, Native American werewolves, Dutch merfolk, Japanese tsukigami, Egyptian mummies, and later installments, Chinese ghosts, psychics, priests, and a bee. You know, that traditional staple of horror movies, bees. Anyway, the basis of the game's world started with the conflict between Morrigan and Dimitri. This was fleshed out into an extremely detailed backstory about a Shinigami named Jedha Doma, who was planned from day one but wouldn't appear until Vampire Savior, trying to merge the spirit realm of Makai with the mortal realm of Earth. You see, Makai has a 5-mile-high mountain and is surrounded by both boiling and frozen oceans. Mechanically, Darkstalkers uses a modified Super Turbo engine, runs on the same CPS2 hardware as that game. Darkstalkers was probably the fastest-paced game of its time, featuring fast walk speeds and great air mobility, a chain combo system where you could cancel normals into normals, as well as snappy meter-based EX moves, air guarding. Darkstalkers basically laid the groundwork that X-Men released just a few months later, and its sequel, X-Men vs. Street Fighter, would run with, codifying the anime air dasher subgenre. Darkstalkers has and always will exist in this weird, like, gray area, blurring the line between anime fighters and more conventional footsie-based games. Of course, it's quite possibly illegal to talk about Darkstalkers and not gush about its lavish animation. The game was a technical benchmark in its time, released in 1994, the same year as Tekken, a year after Virtua Fighter. Darkstalkers managed to push the boundaries of a somewhat aging system and prove that ugly, blocky 3D ain't got shit on beautiful, handcrafted 2D artistry. The game's sprite work is a crash course through the 12 concepts of animation, featuring plenty of squashing, stretching, anticipation, follow-through, and glorious, glorious smear frames. Very few games can match the Darkstalkers trilogy in terms of sheer visual mastery, like maybe Multi-Blood. The game's key and promotional art was also created by the now legendary artist Bengis, best known for drawing Marvel's characters better than Marvel's artists do. You know, actually, it's really wild in retrospect to remember how popular Darkstalkers was back in the day. Now it's paradoxically remembered by everyone as that game forgotten by everybody, but back in the 90s, it was up there with Street Fighter, Marvel, KOF, Sam Show. You know, you could find it anywhere where I lived. Marketing was fierce in those gaming magazines. There'd be, like, ads in every issue of GamePro or EGM. It'd just be like, look at Morgan's ass. In fact, Darkstalkers received a television adaptation before Street Fighter did.
It's enough to make your blood run cold.
What the fuck? Darkstalkers was succeeded by four games that were really just two games. Night Warriors, Darkstalkers Revenge, and Vampire Savior, Lord of Vampire. Vampire Savior was followed by Vampire Savior 2 and, oddly enough, Vampire Hunter 2. Both near identical revisions of VSAV, except the later excludes the new characters from Vampire Savior, instead reinstating the cut characters from the second game, who didn't make it to the third, hence the name. Also, the names are different in all the regions, you know, just to further confuse us. It's Darkstalkers, then Night Warriors, then Vampire Savior here. But in Japan, it's Vampire, then Vampire Hunter, then Vampire Savior. And then Vampire Savior 2 and Vampire Hunter 2. It's a fucking mess, is what it is. Now, the franchise, unfortunately, is on indefinite hiatus, but its specter lives on, with Anakaris, Bulletta, and Felicia appearing in Marvel 2, Bulletta and Cannon Spike Dimitri in Capcom Fighting Jam, Jetta was in Marvel Infinite, and Morrigan is in all of those games, plus Marvel 1, Marvel 3, Ultimate Marvel 3, CVS 1, CVS 2, SNK vs. Capcom for the Neo Geo Pocket, SVC Chaos, Tatsunoku vs. Capcom, Puzzle Fighter, Pocket Fighter, Cross Edge, Project Cross Zone, Namco Cross Capcom, that mobile card game that Justin Wong keeps talking about, that other card game for the Neo Geo Pocket colored Onimusha, Gunbird, fucking Gunbird, the shmup, yes, that Gunbird for the Sega Dreamcast, the console port had Morgan Einzlin in it, for reasons I couldn't even begin to explain to you. Oh, and don't forget the costumes. Oh boy. Anyway, a couple of years ago, Capcom said Darkstalkers isn't dead. So, you know, maybe, please Jesus. Anyway, yeah, that's pretty much the size of it for Darkstalkers 1, an excellent game. Hopefully not a dead game, an undead game even, perhaps, right? So anyway, if you enjoyed the video, like, subscribe, click the spooky bell. Ooh, you know, like in a church, like a graveyard full of ghosts, you hit the bell and it's like ding, ooh. All the zombies come out and they play some Iron Maiden for you, like Zabble. Remember Zabble? So anyway, you know, on Patreon, if you donate $5, we'll do a casual set of whatever game you want. $20 donation entitles you to anything, any video. It's basically a commission, a cheap commission. Where are you going to get a 5-minute video for just $20? Right? Right? Where are you going to get that? I'm underselling myself, and you should take advantage of me. And also buy a t-shirt. You should do that too.